would love to see Burma one day become the kind of country where you can speak, read, write poetry the way your heart tells you to do it.
We're here with Harreld Dinkins, the associate producer of the new film, They Call It Myanmar, Lifting the Curtain. The film was shot covertly in Burma for approximately 3 years, and Harreld joins VOA to tell us why this film remains so unique. Thank you for joining us, Harreld.
Thanks for having me, Kaye.
Harreld, so like I said, why is this film so unique? Why is this so different from the other films that I've seen regarding Burma, regarding politics and the human rights situation in the country?
Well, I think the film is different on a number of different levels. It does not particularly hold itself to most of the films that have been done about Burma so far that have taken place somewhere in the eastern border of Burma. So it doesn't concern itself with a story of ethnic warfare or ethnic oppression as the foreground. It stays pretty timeless and pretty current in spite of the speedy changes taking place throughout Burma now.
So what does it focus on?
Well, it focuses on the experiences of the director, of the filmmaker himself, Bob Lieberman, who shot the film over the course of several years in Burma covertly. He comes at it from a perspective of self-declared naivete, where he doesn't have any particular bundle of knowledge or opinion about the country and goes in with his eyes open. Mm-hmm. And so it's a very self-declared, this is what Burma seems to me to be. Insofar as there's themes that come to the surface, there's quite a lot that you see about what the situation is like inside of Burma, inside of the heartland, not a conflict area per se, but inside of the heartland in Burma about the lack of labor standards, the real gap in any kind of reasonable health care, mm-hmm. with the lack of any kind of real rigor or funding for a decent primary education system. It's stuff that will actually stay relevant.
I saw one clip from They Call It Myanmar, Lifting the Curtain, about child labor and about these children just carrying rocks. They look about 7 or 8 years old. Can you explain that scene and just describe it a little bit?
I think that, again, these themes that you see in the film often influence each other. So the lack of access and affordability of any kind of primary education leaves children with nothing to do but to begin to contribute to earning a living for the family. The lack of any kind of health care makes it all the more important to have some sort of cash on hand. So manual labor, often in the most brutal circumstances, is often the best foot forward in an economically backward and, again, kind of infrastructure poor country. So unfortunately, that is the case, not just for children, but for adults. But it just happened that in that particular scene, we're focusing on the kids, or the filmmaker was focusing on the children.
You had said that Burma is the rice bowl of Asia, or was the rice bowl of Asia. And you said it still is in some ways, you know, or it can still be, is what you're hinting at, is what you're insinuating. So with these new talks of reform in the country, what hopes do you have for the economy of the country, for the social welfare of the country?
Well, that would be speaking not affiliated with the film, but speaking just personally, I would say that Burma is a country of vast resources, both in terms of material resources, which are some of the largest in Southeast Asia, but also in terms of its personal resources, its human resources, its people, of unparalleled ethnic, linguistic, geographic, natural, and social diversity. Burma, I think, has more potential to contribute to itself and towards the region than perhaps any country in Southeast, East, or maybe even South Asia. If that sounds like a grand claim to make, then it certainly might reflect the fact that I think there are a lot of people that have grand hopes for Burma's future.
Lieberman and his crew, they went into the country when Burma was still considered the second most...
No crew.
Okay, so let me rephrase. Burma used to be the second most isolated country in the world, first being North Korea. And While Burma was quote-unquote still considered the second most isolated country in the world, Lieberman went into the nation and filmed people secretively, clandestinely, and people were afraid to even be portrayed on their cameras, on a picture, or even have their voices heard. And now I think about this and say, well, he was disclosing to the world, or trying to disclose to the world, what's going on in the country, about how unfree the country is. So do you think with these new talks of reform happening now between the US, the Western world, and Burma, do you still think that this film is relevant to these times?
I think that it's more relevant than ever. With Burma, right now it seems to me that the country has one foot in the future and one foot in the past. So if these reforms actually consolidate themselves and move forward, then it still actually has tremendous relevance in terms of these issues that Burma faces, in terms of its infrastructure deficits. Child labor problems don't go away overnight. Primary education problems will take decades to build up that capacity to where the country should be. And certainly in terms of a healthcare crisis, Burma has a lot of work to do. And that's assuming that the best case scenarios, with lots of donors internationally and globally helping to fund some of these changes. It's still a long process.
Do you see these signs of reform? Do you see it as hopeful? Are you optimistic about change in the country?
Well, I think that I'm a skeptical optimist, maybe. I think that it's important to recognize that the glass can be, at the same time, half full and half empty. I hope personally that the reforms go further and are able to really solidify themselves and become institutionalized and accepted and defended by everyone. Mm-hmm. I hope. Am I concerned? Yes, there are still prisoners of conscience. There are still ethnic wars being fought against minorities. There are still issues that Burma has to resolve before these reforms can be said to be finished.
One of the questions that people kept asking me, and this is a recurring theme, is where are you from?
Where do you think I come from? Where do I come from? Where do you think I come from? Where am I from? Don't tell.
I actually saw one of his experiences in the country. It was a special feature about when he was walking around Rangoon. He was asking people, do you know where I'm from? This white Caucasian man in Asia, in Burma. And people are saying, yes, you're from somewhere in Europe, from the UK, from France, from London. But nobody had said the United States. And since we are the voice of America, I wanted to know why didn't people know that he was American?
I think there are many reasons for that. I think that, frankly, and rather distressingly, that Americans are not as avid international travelers as many of our international compatriots from around the world.
France. Switzerland.
Australia.
Germany.
About Israel.
American?
Yes.
USA?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
American.
Ooh,
you got it. First, second guess.
American. Yeah.
I think that also it's the case that the U.S. Has been particularly supportive of the NLD, and I'm speaking again here just personally as a Burma-interested person, not as a film affiliate, and saying that the U.S. has been strongly supportive of the lines that the NLD has taken, and so I think that actually that Americans have been particularly prone to avoid travel to the country until the relatively recent edict by the NLD saying that they would support independent travel, careful independent travel.
There are many, many themes to the film, They Call It Myanmar, from sociological aspects to even religion. And I thought it was really interesting, although I haven't even seen the rendition. I thought that what was most interesting was the Buddhism behind this film, the Buddhist thinking. And one of the people had said, well, it's kind of like karma, you know? In Buddhism, we think that, well, we'll accept the way that things are now, but in a future life, my life would be better because of all the good karma that I will do and get. And so I was quite baffled by this, because you can also play devil's advocate and say, hey, you know, the 2007 Saffron Revolution, which was led by Buddhist monks, they believe in karma as well. And they think, you know, karma means if you do good now, it'll reflect in your future. So they're trying to do what they can now to get democracy, and then it'll reflect. So which take is Buddhism for this film?
I don't think that the film has a take. I think that the film shows other people's takes. I think that one of the things that I think is interesting about the film is that it does not portray the opinions of an individual. It does not portray the opinions of sort of a mass of people that we don't get to know. We actually hear the stories of individual people mm-hmm. told in their own words directly to Bob, directly to the filmmaker, directly to the camera. And as such, the film doesn't take any particular position on what or what is not the more popular or the more orthodox or the more accepted explanation for Buddhism or anything else.
But do you believe that many of the people believe in this karma aspect of why the country is the way it has been for so long? I'm using my words.
Are you asking me personally?
Yes, I'm asking you personally, and I'm also asking you as a film affiliate.
I think that the film does not take a position. I think that the film goes quite a way to simply let people tell their own stories. And I don't think that the film is interested in saying that this is the story, mm-hmm. just as saying that these are some stories. I think that's an important distinction. The film goes quite a way as to letting people tell some stories without pretending to tell all of the stories or just a singular story. Mm-hmm. On a personal level, I think that it's impossible to understand any culture anywhere without some recognition of the role that religion plays in that culture's formation and continuance. And yes, I think that I know people that stand on both sides of that perspective of karma as being, we just need to accept where we are and saying that we need to change things for the future. One can take a passive or active attitude towards that.
Let's talk about the name of the movie. They call it Myanmar. So is it Burma or Myanmar? What do we call it?
Well, I would actually ask you the same thing, wouldn't I?
A rose by any other name would still smell as sweet. Isn't that Shakespeare?
Also contentious. I think that both names have certainly a long historic resonance as being traditional names of the country. I mean, it's sort of a tension there, right? Isn't it? In the title, it both refers to they. Who are they? They, the now defunct military regime, they were the ones that announced that it would be called Myanmar. But it's also a name that I think it's more different sounding to an American ear, to a Western ear, to a British ear. You know, Burma, Burmese in France and Burma in the UK, and you know, Burma throughout the English-speaking world has been the more accepted name of the country for a long time. So I think that it sort of highlights, well, what is Myanmar? Who are they? And who are they? How do Americans learn about what's happening in the country if they're not going to go travel? And most of us will not travel to these places. Most of us will not go to the UK or to even Canada. Americans are not the best travelers. But we can still learn about these places. We can still learn to celebrate them.
Okay. Thank you so much for joining us, Harreld. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, Kaye. Great to be here.
Thank you so much.